Then I will go first. My name is Horng Bor. So I started Kyudo 6 years ago. Back then, I was still practicing Shinkendo. So at that point of time, I knew someone called Jeremy, and he told me that he has been looking into another form of martial art, which is Kyudo. And then he told me that he went KL to find some Kyudo group, and eventually he and two other Japanese lady, who is Mariko-san and Eko-san, they founded the club, and I joined Kyudo since ever then. Actually, for me, Kyudo was sort of a godsend, because when I practiced Shinkendo, I really loved the martial art, but I always appreciate Kyudo for its peacefulness, the ability to think upon myself, reflect myself introspectively, and since ever then, I've fallen in love with the martial art. So here I am today. I'm very pleased with the art, and I don't intend to quit anytime soon.
Wait, so you said you had a friend that mentioned that he wanted to do another martial art, or he wanted to do Kyudo. When you first saw it, did you know that it was going to be this type of thing? Because archery is archery. How did you learn more about Kyudo?
He told me about Kyudo. I'm saying, what is it? And then I began to Google about it. It was the way of the bow. And the more I looked into it, the more I appreciate that it's a traditional form of archery. Though today is a bit more modernized, but that was the thing I really wanted to try out, because there wasn't any such a martial art at that point in time in Singapore. So I just think that why not give it a try and see what happens.
So today you're the president of the Singapore Kyudo Association. Maybe just to briefly recap how that kind of came about when you first started to now taking more responsibility.
This role wasn't really, it was put onto me. So at the start, there were so few of us, and we basically have to rely on each other to get better. All we had was the Kyudo textbook, and we were really blessed to have some seniors teaching us and all senseis teaching us from overseas dojo. And as the club started to grow bigger, we realized that there needs to be a structure, there needs to be a committee. Actually, the first president was officially Jeremy, the guy who founded the club together with Mariko-san and Eko-san. So after Jeremy left for Australia, I took up the baton, and then I began to lead the club from then on.
And what does that involve in terms of things that you have to do?
So being a president, meaning I have to think not only for the club in a big picture, but also Kyudo as a martial art in Singapore, how to bring upon its awareness. Because I feel that in Singapore, the top few most popular Japanese martial art are always Kendo, Judo, but not a lot of people knew about Kyudo. So it is sort of my goal and desire to actually spread this wonderful martial art to everyone else. And it's very unique in the sense that it helped me a lot during my stressful times. It allowed me to transport myself away from the buzzy city, the noises, the stress, for ever so short of a moment. Like within the 2 hours, I felt that I truly isolated myself from the outside world. So I would like to, which is why the motivation that I would like to bring this to everyone else, and as a means to help people cope with the city stress.
Yeah, that's wonderful. I just always impressed with people that start a martial art because, oh, this looks cool, or I want to hit a target, or blah, blah, blah. But they realize there's this deeper benefit to it in their daily lives as well. So in this call is kind of special because normally we only have one-on-one, but we have two people here. So Zoel, if you don't mind, could you introduce yourself as well? Talk about how you discovered Kyudo and what it kind of means to you over the last few years of practice.
Yeah, I'm Zoel. I'm also from Singapore. So I came to Kyudo a totally different way. I wasn't looking at martial arts. So I had a pretty heavy personal problem in like 2012. And in 2013, I picked up archery, which is the regular Olympics recurve archery as a hobby to clear my mind away from the stress that I was going through. And I was doing that for a couple of years, after which the range near where I lived closed. So I became like a homeless archer. So looking around at other facilities, they were not really convenient to go to. But somehow or other, I Googled about archery and then Kyudo came up. And I'm like, oh, okay, that's a martial art. Something that, you know, I'm Asian. I've seen many martial arts. And it would be nice to pick up a martial art, you know, to learn more about what it entails. I also have problems with both of my knees, maybe because I played too much basketball when I was young. So there was no way I could do Aikido and stuff like that. You know, they would literally break my knees. So the only physical exercise I can get was from archery. So I took a chance at Kyudo, and back then it was like far, far away on the opposite of end of the island where I lived. Even then, I wasn't sure whether I wanted to continue in Kyudo, because back then we didn't have a proper dojo. It was out in the hot sun, in a grass field. But I think there's something other than the archery that kept me around, and it was the people, the community, and especially Mariko-san and Iko-san, the seniors from Japan. And they had a good vibe around, other than just the practice, there's this sense of peace when you are practicing it. So I stuck around and eventually took a trip to Tokyo to the actual dojo and practiced there, and I got hooked. So in the end, Horng Bor became the president, and I was also thrown into being the vice president. But I, to be honest, I lean very heavily on Horng Bor, because he has brought the club to a different level. And all I can do is give him as much support as I can from what I am able to do on my end. So that's how I got into Kyudo. And it has been an amazing journey so far.
Great. So similarly, Horng Bor had given a really grand and very nice vision of where he sees Kyudo in Singapore happening. What is kind of your take on it? What would you like to see most promoted in terms of Kyudo amongst the Singaporeans?
I feel that, you know, we are Asians, and in Asian culture, we have a certain sense of respect, especially for elders, or, you know, we would call someone an older gentleman like uncle, right? An older gentleman, older elder lady, auntie, and so on. And I feel that in Singapore, as we modernize, such respect has been waning. And I don't see young people calling me uncle, and because you're getting too westernized. And Kyudo is something that I would like to inculcate the younger generation that are involved, to teach them to remember this aspect. Other than, you know, it's a Budo, so there's always a certain level of respect for one another. So I would like them to remember the values of an Asian martial art. If every other martial art also has this. So my goal is to make sure it remains that way. And I don't want it to just be about the ceremonial movements and the shooting, and we forget about the etiquette.
Yeah, that's a great point. Like, personally, I do Iaido, Kendo, and Kyudo. And I found that with Kendo and Iaido too, there are dojos that are leaning more towards traditional, others are leaning more towards competitive and sport and Western ways. But Kyudo is consistently, no matter which dojo you go to, there is this aspect of etiquette and tradition inside it, no matter where you go. So yeah, I think that that's a really great point. But that also brings us to this challenge that you have in Singapore. While you are in Asia, you're connected to like Malaysia and that area of the world. Singapore is one of the most multicultural kind of cities or countries in the world. So how have you seen that kind of integrate into your society, and how Kyudo kind of fits into this world? Because I'm even looking at your website, it says to bring Kyudo to anyone, no matter their origins. And I think that's a very Singaporean saying, because yeah, it's such a transient place. People come from all over the world, stay for a little bit and then leave, and then new people come. So how do you see that fitting into society there?
It's a balance, to be honest. When the club was younger, I was pushing really hard for this. In the end, because we both of us have gone to Tokyo to the Real Dojo, and that is full on Japanese culture, Japanese etiquette, and it's so different. But over here in Singapore, it's far too casual, in my opinion. So, in leading the younger, the Kohai, I find that if I was too strict on this, it's not going to work. We are Singaporeans, we are not Japanese, and we will never be Japanese because our upbringing is different. So it is finding a balance between being Singaporean and the etiquette and culture of Kyudo, which origin comes from Japan. So just enough that if my Kohai goes to Japan, to the dojo, they should know enough to not embarrass themselves.
Horng Bor, can you comment on this aspect of Singaporean culture and how you see Kyudo fitting in?
Right. So when our club was under the highlight, under Channel News Asia, where they did a scope on us, showcasing us as a very unique martial art in Singapore, one of the comments that struck me really hard is that someone mentioned that Singapore society is not ready for such a refined martial art yet. So at that point in time, it sort of resonated with me because in terms of country history, we are a very young nation. Everyone is so desperately trying to be successful in life. As such that, like what Zoel mentioned, courtesy, considerations, etiquettes, all these values that generally the older generation, they value, are getting lost in the younger generation. So it is both Zoel's and my vision and hope that to make politeness, etiquettes, and all the values that make a person good, cool again. It's about making Kyudo cool, even despite with all these ceremonies, etiquettes, all these troubles that people say they have to go through just to practice, just to shoot an arrow. Like, who will actually spend five minutes shooting two arrows? That's a waste of time, some people commented. And that was quite brutal. So, and I'm glad that throughout these 6 years, we have found many people who really devoted themselves into the martial art, and they see the goodness in it. They see that they benefited. And I can say those who stayed for longer than 1 year, you could see that they did change in personality. They become more balanced, they become more mature, and they tend to think more before they speak. So this, I feel like we are getting much and much closer to our vision of having a very culturally advanced society. So I hope that one day the person will change the perspective of Singapore society, that we are more than what he claimed that us to be.
I also find it very interesting that you guys, both of you, are talking about this older view, like how elders are respected in a certain way. You want to provide this tradition, this culture back to the younger generation. And yet you guys can't be over 40. You look like in your 30s, in your early 30s, you're not old at all. So why do you see this gap between like your generation? The next generation is less than 10 years younger than you.
So both Zoya and me, our zodiac, Chinese zodiac, is dragon. So Zoya is 12 years older than me. So I'm 32 today, this year. Zoel, if I'm not wrong, you're 44, right?
Yeah, that's correct.
But, yeah. So essentially, we are one generation apart. And that is what makes us so special. Because today, the main goal of inviting Zoel is to prove that even between different generations, we have much to learn from each other. And there's always harmony to be balanced between even the older generation that you tend to be always at odds with. In fact, during the management of the club, we do have many debates. But end of the day, we know that no matter what we decided on, what we argue about is for the best of the club. And these are some of the things, the examples that I really hope the members of our club can see us as a good role model. And they can learn.
Yeah, no, that's a wonderful demonstration and modeling of the type of behavior you're trying to ask for. Zoel, do you want to comment on that generation gap? How do you see that working, and how do you want to use this as something to help the next generation or the students in your Kyudo club understand what that means?
I guess it's for the older generation to set a good example to the next group. And just because you're older doesn't mean you're always correct. So I do learn a lot from Horng Bor. He has a lot of drive, very entrepreneurial, not something that I am. I'm a much quieter person, to be honest. So, but as each generation in Singapore, I see, because being older, I've seen more change. And it's nice to see that, yeah, even though it's 12 years after me, Horng Bor is still holding on to that, the values. And the next group that is 12 years after, it may be more diminished, but we hope to inculcate them. Kyudo is a martial art that is very tedious, and it involves a lot of it's not just the movements, even like you're taking care of your equipment, your uniform. As with most martial art, it's a tedious thing, and most people in Singapore, being in this rushed society, especially the younger ones, are always like, they want things instant, right? It's like fast food. So are you willing to take your time in things and not rush things? Do things slowly, the little details, take a breath, you know, calm down, and it'll be good for you. So yeah, it's about setting the example at the moment.
Yeah, and when you said that, Zoel, when you were first starting, you had gone to Japan, and then later on, you probably had some more trips. And even in Singapore, you were influenced by those two more senior Japanese ladies. Could you talk a little bit about what you've learned over the course of Kyudo so far about Japanese culture? What were challenging things? What were things that seemed to come naturally? And how do you want to learn more and bring more of that back to the club?
I think the examples that they set is they have this much more community culture in the club. And that's the aspect that we're trying to build a community. I think a lot of the life in Singapore has been more selfish, so to speak, because you're trying to do stuff to gain for your own sake, rather than doing things freely for other people's sake. So that's the biggest thing I learned from the Japanese senpais and those in Japan. Also, they're very giving. Incredibly giving, very generous. So I've learned a lot about that aspect. So it's not so much about shooting, but all the values that I've learned the most from them.
Horng Bor, your take on that? You're on mute still.
So I did went to Japan with Zoel. So we went back to Hamacho Dojo, which is the dojo of one of our founders, Mariko-san. And the first time when we were there, we were really very nervous. So it's kind of a very interesting experience because as much as they are giving, they are very incredibly disciplined. We were so afraid of stepping on etiquette mines. So once you start inside a dojo, you need to bow first. You need to set up your bowl first before you wear your hakama. Everything has a step to it. There's a way, even if I want to put giriko, which is a powder on my glove, I have to be facing the azuchi, the target area. All these tiny little details really sort of overwhelm us at the start. But getting past that is actually underlying there's a fundamental thinking that it's a privilege for all of them to be able to have a dojo to train in the first place. And even though they have the most well-equipped dojo in Japan, there are dojos everywhere, they do not take it for granted. Every member, every Japanese member, they take their own initiative to maintain the dojo, to return everything back to its own position, location. And this is something actually we struggled for a very long time when we first have our initial batch of newcomers, because everyone after training, they just went back home. They didn't help. They didn't know what to do. There was no initiative. So that really saddened me and Zoel quite a lot. And I'm glad over these years, we have managed to slowly teach them that all these are privileges. They are not to feel entitled to what they have now. Everything is precious, especially land in Singapore. To have a 28-meter range and a dojo to train, we are really, really lucky.
Yeah, so let's talk about this trip. You mentioned learning from scratch, like how to behave inside a dojo. What else was memorable about this one? Maybe first Zoel and then back to Horng Bor. Talk about this trip.
Are you able to see the screen?
Yes.
Okay, so that's the dojo. So this is the first trip to a genuine dojo in Japan, and never thought I would end up in such a position. You know, it's something to cherish, a good memory. And we were there, and there was so, yeah, it was overwhelming, like Horng Bor said, so many etiquettes to do. The discipline is important, and you have to always face dazuchi, whether you're putting on your glove or giriko powder. And if the sensei appears, you gotta take off everything and go and greet the sensei. And that's the way it is in Japan. It has to do with etiquette and discipline. And I feel that, yeah, that's something that's lost in Singapore. The little ones, when their grandparents appear, they don't go and greet their grandparents. So, and we had a trainees, it's, although it's like, it was tiring. We were training morning into the afternoon. And at that time, I was also trying to figure out how to shoot the bow, and also trying to buy a bow, because you don't have kudo shops in Singapore. And that was tricky, because I don't know how strong I was going to get. So we fortunately the amateur dojo had a few spare bows and many senseis to teach us. So they were super, super generous. They'll bring us out to dinner after the shooting, and we'd eat, we'd talk, we'd drink, and go around Tokyo and other places. So the weather's cold, and this is the first time we shoot in the cold weather. It was really cold in the morning, especially. So it's something I'm not used to. So I got all my equipment, and I think in this picture I was using my new bow at the time, and Horng Bor as well. So I'm very, very grateful.
Have you guys done any subsequent trips with more of your members?
To Japan, well, the first shooter here is Horng Bor, and then that's myself. And the other two are also early members in the club. So we did go back one more time, I think the year after. And that was when Horng Bor was taking his Nidan exam at Meiji Jingu. Now, I have personal restrictions when it comes to dojo. So I'm a Christian, just so you know. So practicing kudo is, well, some dojos like Hamacho Dojo is built in a sports complex. And they are neutral. But other dojos are associated with a shrine, or like Meiji Jingu. It's part of the place. So, because that dojo has a kamidana, that's a Japanese altar where the kamizai is, you have to bow to it when you enter. And that's something I cannot do because of my faith. So I had to skip the Shinsan that year. But yeah, as long as it's just the national flag of the country or a club flag, it's fine with me. Yes, I have no restrictions on that. So yeah, it's just one of those things for me.
Okay, so Horng Bor, can you maybe talk about that experience of you having to go there? If it was already Nidan, that means you had already done a grading previously, but it's always it's always special doing something at Meiji Jingu. It's like such a traditional, like old place, and it's like huge and a very beautiful kyudojo there. Can you talk about that experience?
Oh yes. So the previous year, I actually went to Nagoya. So they have a Nagoya Sports Center. At that point in time, the dojos were rather standard as your typical dojo. It was quite enclosed. But Meiji Jingu is in another level. It was so spacious that the steps we take to just enter the dojo was twice as much as the one in Nagoya. So the bigger the space, the grander it is, the more stressful I get about the exam. And the funny thing is that during that year, we actually did a little training beforehand at Hamajo Dojo. And there was another Dan Sensei who taught me. Coincidentally, he was one of the sensei that was judging me on my Nidan exam. My face, when I turned up and I saw him, my face turned white immediately. It was so scary. And that was one of the most interesting experience I had for that Nidan exam. So, and I could tell that he was like scrutinizing me and I didn't want to disappoint him. Luckily, I did manage to pass it.
When you make a trip just for training compared to a trip where you have a grading coming up, there definitely is a little added intensity. So did you find that you had to be at the dojo more? It's less leisurely. It's not as like a sightseeing trip as much as you had to spend more time preparing?
Yes, definitely. So when we have a seminar and a shinsa grading exam, practically the schedule is always from morning 8 a.m. Until 5 p.m. So sometimes it will end earlier, maybe about late noon, 3 p.m. But it's almost always a full day. So the leisure timing will always, we always plan our leisure time after the exam or before the exam. So I think during that year, we schedule our additional training at Hamajo Dojo before the grading exam. So we were trying to fix all our stuff before going for the grading exam. And after that, we will go hang out somewhere with other people.
Cool. So let's go back to Singapore. Zoel, you were talking about when you first joined, there was no proper kyudojo. You were out in a field in the sun. Could you talk about, over the course of the years, how did you guys end up having a dojo and what was that process in getting it?
Yeah, that's a good one. Maybe I can find some photos while I talk. So when they founded the club, they were looking for a place to practice. And they got with a community club, which is, you know, government-run clubs. Yeah, there we go.
Yeah.
And they found this community club is in charge of this field, which I think originally was a soccer field. And it was then converted to a recurve archery field. So they asked for permission, and this is where we got the permission to shoot here as well. So I joined after they had gotten this place, and it's not the most pleasant thing because this is not a dojo. This is just a field. And when it rains, it's incredibly muddy and soggy. If it doesn't rain, you're pretty much baking out in the sun. If you shoot low, your arrows are going to disappear into the grass and you're going to have a hard time looking for it. It might be a bit expensive if you can't find it. So fortunately, one of the two founding ladies, Aiko-san, she's already gone back to Japan. Her children were studying at the Japanese primary school, and she asked them for permission whether we could rent the school hall, or which in Japanese they call it the gym of the school, and where the students would play basketball and stuff. So we asked if we could rent that place, and the school was generous enough, and they agreed. Although there's one restriction, and that we were not allowed to shoot 28 meters because they fear that we might damage the hall when the arrows go flying to the other end. So what we did is we strung up a net across the middle of the hall, and we shoot into it. So I think it's something like 15 meters the most. So it's kind of like you're shooting into Makiwara all the time. So we got, as a club, got really, really good in our tie high, the ceremonial movement. But when we actually shoot 28 meters, when we visit other clubs overseas, we were really, really inaccurate. We had the best tie high, but the worst shooting. So I was glad that we moved to the school. At least that got us out of the sun and the rain. And we could actually learn and do a proper tai hai over there. If not, you can't really learn tai hai on grass, that's for sure. And between tai hai and shahu hatsetsu, which is the shooting, there is, according to our senpais, that tai hai does hold a lot of weight. You might be able to shoot well, but if you can't do your tai hai, that's not going to help you either. So it was good that we could move on. Subsequently, we finally moved to the current dojo we have. So before the COVID situation, we managed to find a range that is under a flyover of a road. So this gave us an opportunity to shoot 28 meters. And the only difference between the school hall and this is that this place is right beside the major junction of a road. And you have a lot of heavy vehicles going past that. So this is not the quietest dojo in the world. I think it's probably the noisiest dojo in the world. However, we have improved on our shooting, and everyone seems to like, I think it's good way to keep your mind focused on what you're doing. Because yes, a quiet, peaceful Zen dojo, like a nice Zen garden in Japan, is a nice place to do Kyudo. However, in this situation, if you're still able to concentrate, you must be really good at what you're doing. So thankful that we have come to our third home, and hopefully we'll find an even better place than this in the future.
I really like that comment. Absolutely smart way of using the space up. Yeah, totally. Horng Bor, do you want to add anything to that story of progression from the soccer field to the school to underneath this overpass?
Right. So I just want to express my gratitude towards the owner of this range. This range is actually called Sword and Light Archery Range. They contacted us after we got interviewed by Channel News Asia, and while everyone was like talking about how slow our form of archery is and all, and they were the only one who looked all the way the bottom of the article, we were practically asking for help. It was like, we wrote there, actually, we are trying to look for a new location. And thankfully, they actually came to ask us if they would like to join us as part of one of their communities there. And I just want to emphasize that SNL is really a very good range because their hope and wishes is are always to combine all forms of archery under a single roof. So they will actually housing even traditional archery in Singapore, and of course us, which became the second biggest group under this range. So really thanks to them that we are able to get such a fine dojo. And they really respected our martial art. During the construction of the new dojo, they have two range. So first range and second range, they are totally on the opposite end of the junction. When they were building the second range, they actually asked us the dimension of our dojo. At that point in time, I got really touched that they took such a they were so considerate to ask us, and they understood the importance of the ceremonial, the tie-hai to us. So yeah, this place couldn't have been a better place for us.
Yeah, it's always great that when we find that we don't actually promote ourselves, it's just these traditional martial arts enough. We like put out these articles, but when we do, really great things usually happen. Like in this case, you found a space, you usually find some really great members through just happenstance reading an article, even though that might be the only one in 10 years that you release. So we talked about the dojo here. I want to ask you about, now that you mentioned that in Japan, especially you experienced the community feel, like you don't just leave after practice, there's talking, there's getting together. What kind of traditions have you guys developed in the Singapore club in terms of what do you do besides the practice?
One fun fact about the interaction with our senpai and senseis in Japan, they train hard, they also enjoy themselves very hard. So Japanese, they love their nomi kai, right? So back there, we always call the meal after training as a daini dojo, the second dojo. And then I think this got into Zoel and me, and really love the aspect of having to enjoy a meal together with the members after a hard day of training. And that really bonds us together as a community. And I mean, what is better than after training so hard and then sitting down, enjoying a meal, drinking some beer, and then just talking about life with members? I think this is one of the bliss of life, I feel.
And what is it like in Singapore? What do you guys do in that sense? Like, what kind of restaurants do you go to? What kind of food do you eat? Who goes? What kind of conversations do you have?
Usually, on the day itself, we will have a food in charge. So that person will actually decide which restaurant we will go to and eat. So it's not a regular restaurant. There isn't a regular restaurant that we always go to. We'll try to spice things up, like, hey, today we're eating Indian food, come on, let's go. Today we are eating Taiwanese food, let's go. So I mean, we always like change once in a while, keep things fresh.
Zoel, what do you feel about the traditions you're starting to create in the Singapore club that's more similar to like those Japanese dojos?
Well, beyond food and drink, what I've done is to take our Japanese friends out and tour Singapore. I've done it a few times already with Mariko-san and others. Maybe because we are a bit, they are older than I am, so I'm closer in age to them and can than Horng Bor is. So maybe we talk a little more older stuff. But it's a return of favor as well, because when we were in Japan, Mariko-san would take us all over the place, and over here we do the same. So other than Singapore, when there are Southeast Asian Kyudo gatherings, we will go as a group. So we have been to Kuala Lumpur in Malaysia, Bangkok, Thailand, and is there one more place? Oh yes, that's Makati in Philippines. So yeah, there was a Southeast Asian gathering once a year. Although lately nothing's happening because of COVID, but yeah. So going around as a group and touring them around Singapore as well.
Yeah, I'm hoping that when I get a chance to come to Singapore, I get the same treatment.
Oh yes, don't worry about that. Yeah.
So do you have any other photos you want to share and talk about? I noticed quite a few tabs open, whether it's happening in Singapore or one of these Southeast Asian trips. Cool. So this is
the Bangkok one.
Yeah. So we went to Thailand, Bangkok, which I think, is this the third Southeast Asia gathering or the second one?
I've lost count. I don't know.
Yeah. So this is actually, this was actually one of the bigger Southeast Asia gathering. And we have over 7 countries participating, and we have a few from Japan, Taiwan, Vietnam, Philippines, Hong Kong. So we always try to make it a point to host such event to promote regional cohesiveness, exchanges between each countries. So we really enjoy ourselves at Thailand. I believe this was an old soccer field. I might be wrong, but basically they have a setup that is really very suitable for a Q dojo, whereby this part you see is the old shelter structure, and then the rest to the right side is all entirely filled. So I really love their dojo, as it's quite airy. Yeah, and this is one of the more memorable ones where we get to interact with many people and really enjoy Thai food in general.
Zoel, what do you remember from that trip?
I think this is one that has a good competition. So we had this kin mato, this go mato, which is extra small. And I think this is the first time I got to participate in a kin mato competition. So if you know about kin mato, is like the first person to hit it wins the prize, it regardless. Usually it starts from the most junior members, and then you move up to the Shodan, and then the Nidan and Sandan until someone hits. So it was an interesting day because it took a while before someone actually hit the motto. That's what I remember from this one.
Cool. So Southeast Asia, actually, in Kyudo, I know it's not been around very long, but like you guys, even 6 years is probably considered one of the more mature countries. How have you seen Kyudo develop in that region over the last few years?
Okay, got it. Kyudo is still relatively young in Southeast Asia, but I would say some of the more established one is like the photo you see here, the group in Malaysia. They have a good facility in the badminton court place. and they do have a good 28 meter range. But moving onwards, I think as all the Southeast Asian clubs gather enough experience and all the members as they learn and go for Shinsas and as they move on. Right now, I think like the more senior levels is level 3, Sandan. So I haven't, I do not remember a Yondan, a level 4 yet. So one day we will have one, and hopefully down further in the future, one of the Southeast Asian members would become a sensei. So that would be a good position for us, because Taiwan has their sensei, and that would be a dream for us.
So yeah, the challenges for Southeast Asia countries have always been, I think for most martial arts, have been the facility itself. Second, is actually the knowledge. So the legitimacy, the authenticity of the knowledge that you learn from is very important for our martial art. For Kyudo, it's very easy to get into what we call a kusei, a bad habit. So especially when you have a target, you want to hit it so badly, and then you will just try to do some shortcut in your form and make sure that you're always consistent in the shooting, which is why the chain of teaching is very important. In Southeast Asia, we tend not to group ourselves as really the South of Asia, but the Taiwanese, the Hong Kong, they have been very helpful in reading this region. And they are both member nations under IKYF. And then they have been communicating with the Malaysian side. And we see Malaysia as a central hub for Kyudo in Asia. They have been getting quite a lot of support from IKYF, and which is why I think a lot of countries actually look up to Malaysia. And furthermore, I think, which is why it's even more important that we hold this yearly Southeast Asia gathering. It's because that there is such exchanges. Therefore, we are able to learn from each other. By the time IKYF is able to send some sensei down here, I think it will be a bit too late. So we are very grateful for all the helps for other countries. And we also appreciate the friendship. We had a lot of fun together during all these events. So I'm thankful for that.
Great. Thank you so much. This has been a great conversation. I'm really glad that you invited Zoel, because I found this back and forth between you two very natural and very supportive. So I had a lot of fun in this conversation. Yeah. I do have some like those rapid fire questions, just fun stuff to get to know each of you a little better. This should be relatively quick, but was there anything else that you wanted to bring up in terms of a photo or an experience that you wanted to talk about?
I can share one. Let me share the screen. So this is Nobuyuki Sensei. He was honorary president of ANKF, and he passed in 2018 at age of 95. So the interesting thing about it is that I have met him. He's a 10th dan, and so it happened back in 2013 or 2014, and I was doing my recurve archery, and I took a trip to Japan, and it was even a solo trip, right? I decided to tour Kyushu, and one of the stops was Nagasaki. So I was just walking around Nagasaki, looking at What happened is the school where the atomic bomb had incinerated. And on the way down, I walked past this dojo that was next to canal. I'm like, wow, I need to see this. You know, I need to see this. And I walked up to the dojo and I asked someone who met me at the door, could I take a look inside? You know, could I even try it? Yeah, of course, I knew nothing about Kyudo at the time. And the young man said, I'm sorry, this is Kyudo, it's a martial art. We don't just have strangers coming in like this. You know? However, an older gentleman came over and also spoke with me, and he was like, okay, is that, there's a sensei here, we will go in and ask if he would allow you to sit and watch him. And that happened to be Nobuyuki sensei. So I was given permission, I went in, I sat there, I sat down and I watched him shoot two arrows. It was like interesting. Of course, at that time, I didn't know who he was. That's the interesting thing about it. And as I was leaving the dojo later, the young man came back to me and said, you are very, very lucky. You know, a few people get to see Nobuyuki sensei shoot the arrows. And again, I was confused. I had no idea why I was so lucky. So in a way, that mysterious visit put in a something about Kyudo into my head that later on made me practice Kyudo. So if I can go back in time and somehow talk to this sensei and said and tell him, hey, you know, I'm practicing Kyudo now and I'm a shodan, and that would be interesting. So that's an interesting story for you.
Yeah, that's amazing. You like having that experience, you would have been what, 90 at the time already. So very rare to shoot at all at that age. Yeah, you have no choice but to continue Kyudo for the rest of your life because of that.
Maybe.
Horng Bor, did you want to share anything before we get into the last wrap up questions?
Oh yeah, sure. Okay, so this is the Nagoya dojo. So these people, they are my very first tachi mates. So we sort of took shodan exam together, and it was at that point of time I'm sort of semi enlightened by and impressed by Kyudo, because within this short span of 2 to 3 days, I have made very good friends with people all over the world. So the lady here, she's from Australia. This guy, Kenny, he's from Malaysia. And these two, they are from Vietnam, Hanoi Kyudo Club. So just simply within 2 to 3 days, we form quite a very strong relationship. And then from then on, I was really hooked onto Kyudo. I really loved the community. It was at that point in time, I realized that, hey, there's a broader world outside Singapore, and I'm starting to like Kyudo and the interaction between people. It feels so great to meet like-minded people. This actually propelled me to and motivate me to do better for the community in Singapore, because I want them to enjoy the same experience as I do.
Yeah, I had kind of forgotten about this, because I haven't practiced Kyudo in 6 years at least. Yeah, and I had forgotten that when you're put into a tachi, either at a seminar or taikai or grading, it could be people from all over, and because it's based on your experience and then also based on your age, it's pretty much people that are your age from different countries, you can get along very easily, very quickly.
Yeah,
that's something that's a great thing to experience about Kyudo. Like compared to a lot of these other martial arts, one-on-one fights or like in archery where it's just competition, individuals. Right. In this case, it's almost like creating a team.
Yeah.
And then
there is a lot of teamwork involved because back in Singapore, the tempo that we have, there's a particular tempo to your steps. Su, su, haku, haku. I'm sure you know. So in Singapore, we tend to do it really slowly. And everyone basically, when we first form the tachi together, everyone has different tempos. So it really takes a lot of teamwork, a lot of trust, a lot of understanding and communication to do this, do the tai hai beautifully as one team. This is one part I really enjoy.
Cool. So let's get into just the final wrap-up questions.
Sure.
So you guys can take turns answering. The first question is, do you have a quote or a proverb or a motto or some kind of line that you think about, whether in your life or in your practice?
Well, maybe from Yoda in Star Wars, do or do not. There is no try. So if you're gonna, especially a martial art like Kyudo, I feel that don't try Kyudo. You either do it or you don't do it. Because if you just try it out, you're not gonna go the distance and accomplish anything at all. You'll never get to even shodan because it takes a lot of work to learn all the how to shoot, how to do tai hai. So do it, don't try it.
Horng Bor, have you been able to think of one?
No, can I skip this?
All right, so next question, you try to start this one.
Okay.
What have you changed your mind in over the last few years? Something that you believe strongly was one way, but now you believe it's another way. Something you didn't know was as important before, but is more important these days.
Like what Zoel said before, I am an entrepreneur. So being the president, I always try to make very, very drastic changes. I will try to suggest something that really push the club forward that I believe there is really the right direction to go. But during those years, the past few years, I feel that I've been a bit too extreme. And I tend to hurt people along the way. Nowadays, I tend to really take a step back and really sit back and listen to what everyone has to say and really consider not only just their rationale, but also their feelings.
Great. And Zoel?
I have two things I learned over time. The first one is like the total opposite to Horng Bor. So I think I'm not an entrepreneur. I'm much more conservative. So, but if not for Horng Bor, we wouldn't be where we are at now. So he surely did something correct. And I have to applaud him for that. The other thing I learned is that, like I said before, we are not Japanese and we are Singaporean. So the way Singaporeans interact among each other is different from Japanese. So we had been to Hamacho Dojo and we learned all the etiquette there, how the Japanese do things in Japan and how they practice Kyudo. And in the beginning, I thought maybe we could do the same here in Singapore. Yeah. But I've learned that I need to find a sort of a middle ground that is still respectable. And just to know that, to accept and to be proud that we're Singaporeans and that we're not Japanese.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm hearing that a lot from a lot of people from different countries, recognizing that although we're bringing in a Japanese martial art into our countries, it can't be purely, it can't be the same thing. So, and I think that's a good thing. It's adapted a lot of the good thing parts about Japanese culture and the good parts about our own culture and Singaporean culture can merge together into creating something that's really great for the people in your country. Because that, in that sense, like that's the point of bringing something like a Japanese martial art into Singapore, is hopefully it'll help make Singaporeans better in some ways. So the next question is a much lighter one. What do you consider your comfort food? Zoel, you can start this one.
That's easy. It's a very particular tsukemen ramen from a very particular ramen shop here in Singapore. Horng Bor knows which one it is.
Sampote?
Yeah, that's the one.
The dipping one?
Yes, yes. They did really, really well. So yeah, I enjoyed that one.
Nice. And Horng Bor?
Yeah. Mine is a very typical Japanese breakfast. It's called TKG, Tamago Kake Gohan. So what they do is they'll have a bowl of rice, they put the egg on it and some shoyu and mix it around. There you go, a perfect meal.
Oh yeah. Actually, I seem to remember my mom growing up with that too in Hong Kong. So I don't think it's necessary just a Japanese meal, but yeah. Hot rice with some egg mixed into it, soy sauce. So Horng Bor, why don't you start this last one? If someone were to open up your YouTube homepage, YouTube recommends videos based on what you commonly watch. What will we see YouTube recommending to you?
Three things. Of course, Kyudo videos, travel videos, and food video channels. So I'm a very lifestyle person. I believe in train hard and also enjoy life hard. So that's what you will see on my YouTube feed.
What's one channel or video that you watched recently that you think you want to share it for other people to see?
So I've been watching this one channel called Best Ever Food Review Show. He has been introducing Vietnamese food. And it was a pity that time that the next Southeast Asia gathering was supposed to be held in Hanoi, Vietnam. So ever since then, I've been watching Vietnamese food channels. So hopefully one day I get to go there and have the gathering with them.
Yeah, by the time you go, you'll be an expert on what kind of food to choose.
Right.
And Zoel, what would YouTube recommend to you?
Basketball. I do follow the NBA all these years. Other than that, it would be stuff to do with a bit more engineering things. So like SpaceX, how they are launching their rockets to space. I watch Adam Savage test it, how he makes stuff. So craft items. And occasionally some music. There's a really good Japanese young man that plays the guitar really, really well. So yeah, a bit of a mixed bag.
Well, just for my own curiosity, what basketball channels are you watching?
MLG highlights. It's more like NBA season highlights. I support Golden State Warriors firstly, but there are a few other players that I do enjoy following. Do you watch basketball?
Oh yeah, I watch it. I have three channels that I like to watch that talk about stuff like who are the top 10 whatever players. There's this one called Johnny Arnett. He's been doing this thing like, if this person didn't exist, then who would win MVP, or who was the actual best player during this time period, during the 70s, 80s, 80s, 90s. There's another one, Coach, I forget what his name is, but he's like a college coach something. And he analyzes like the game, saying, okay, what happened here?
Yeah, I do watch one of this guy as well. I forget his name too, but yeah, he kind of breaks down some of the plays and what players are doing wrong by the way they dribble or shoot. That's pretty cool.
Yeah, and is it the same one where he invites like some former referees
yes,
to talk about
exactly
whether this is a foul? Yeah. Okay, cool. Yeah, we watch the same one. Yeah. He's very funny with the commercials. He's got like commercials on like man beauty products, manly beauty.
Yeah. Or Seat Geek or something, right?
Yeah. All right. So this has been a great conversation. Thank you guys so much. I just want to always give you guys a chance to leave a message, something in closing to the audience. Zoel, why don't you start? Is there anything you want to say in closing for this interview?
I hope that Kyudo is a journey that teaches you patience and perseverance. Because even for myself, you will hit a wall. You might be shooting like really good, and then suddenly everything goes south. Everything goes wrong. And then suddenly your arrows start hitting the ground. And you got to work through these things and come out on the other end, because you're going to hit another wall, and this is going to be a regular thing in Kyudo. So I think it's Kyudo is more of teaching you to have a good building up your character, less soul to me than it is about the movements and the shooting, but it's about building your own character.
Thank you for that. And Horng Bor?
Mine is somewhat like Zoel. I just want to say that Kyudo is really not so much about shooting, nor the tie-high, not the etiquettes. It's what it is to you that gives you what you need. Kyudo is nothing more than a mirror, a reflection that one person would need to look upon themselves to improve. I mean, the arrow can only fly straight. If it doesn't hit the target, I mean, what else could be wrong, right? So I hope people really can try Kyudo out and see how it goes for them.
Great. Thank you guys so much for this. I really enjoyed this conversation. I hope you guys have a great night and stay safe, stay healthy, and we'll hopefully see you sometime in the future.
Thank you, Patrick. See you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Patrick. If you do come to Singapore, please let us know.
Will do. All right. Good night.
See ya.
Bye.
Good night.
Hey guys, I hope you enjoyed that episode, because we have a lot more exciting conversations to share as we explore the world of the traditional Japanese martial arts. The Inside Look podcast is available on most common podcasting platforms and on YouTube. Remember to subscribe to not miss out on new interviews as they are posted. We're always looking for feedback to improve, so please write us a review or drop us a line at podcast@tokushikai.ca or on Facebook and Instagram @tokushikai.canada. Until next time, thanks for listening.